because if we hold to that, all a man would have to do would be count whether they use the lunar calendar, 360 days a year, or 365 days a year with the solar calendar, count 7 years, and with a little bit of math, he'd be able to calculate the exact second coming of Christ to the exact day. And Jesus said that can't be done. So I just wanted to bounce that off you guys. What do you think of that?
Well, so I think that that there are a few things to be concerned. There are a few things that I could say in response to that. One of them is that people who advocate a pre-tribulation rapture, and I should explain that term for people who may not be familiar with it. This is an idea that got started in the 19th century, and it became popular in some, but not all, segments of Protestantism. The basic idea is that there will be a future thousand-year period where Jesus reigns on earth from Jerusalem. And before that thousand-year period, there will be a shorter window of time, typically said to be 7 years long, in which the Antichrist will reign on earth. And then right before, and that's called the tribulation, and then right before that period, Jesus will return and snatch away all of the living Christians as well as the deceased Christians and take them to heaven with him so that they don't have to experience the tribulation. That's why it's called the pre-tribulation rapture, because this rapture or catching away of Christians occurs before the tribulation, and then at the end of the tribulation, Jesus will come back and destroy the Antichrist and then set up his earthly kingdom for 1,000 years. And the Catholic Church does not teach this, and historically, most Protestants have not either. This is a phenomenon this is an idea that's believed in only certain segments of Protestantism. So, I would say that what Jesus is saying is impossible to predict is his coming for the rapture, and that could happen at any time, and so that is genuinely unpredictable. But then once that happens, it would be possible to at least estimate how long it will be before Jesus returns again in order to destroy the Antichrist and set up his earthly kingdom. So I think that that's an argument that a pre-tribulational rapturist could make against this. I would go a step further and say that, and this is an opinion that not everybody shares, but it happens to be mine. If you look at Mark chapter 13, where we have Jesus's statement about no man knows the day or the hour, the context in which he's discussing it is not the second coming. If you look at the beginning of Mark 13, Jesus has just predicted the destruction of the Jewish temple, and then he crosses the Mount of Olives with the disciples, and they say, okay, tell us more about this. Tell us more about the destruction of the temple and what's going to be the sign that it's going to happen and so forth. And Jesus gives a big, long speech, which all deals with the destruction of the temple in the first century. And so, to my mind, exegetically, what Jesus is saying there is not that it's impossible to predict the second coming, but that it's impossible to predict the day on which the temple will be destroyed. Now, I think it's also true that it's impossible to predict when the second coming is going to happen. There's been a spectacular record of failure in people trying to predict that. So I don't think you can predict the second coming either, but I don't think that's actually what Jesus is saying in this passage. And so I would tend to argue against the pre-tribulational rapture on other grounds. The passage where Paul does discuss a rapture-like event is 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. And if you read 1 and 2 Thessalonians and you carefully track what Paul says about Jesus' coming, it's clear that this is not a rapture that occurs before a tribulation that occurs more than 1,000 years before the end of the world. It's something that occurs right at the end of the world.
Frank, it's time for us to take our first break. So I'll say thank you very much for that question. Lots more folks on the line ready to ask Jimmy questions. So we'll continue with Open Forum with Jimmy Akin right after this.
We're here for you. Call now. Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
EWTN Global Catholic Network is the largest religious media network in the world. 11 global TV channels, English and Spanish radio networks with over 500 AM and FM radio affiliates, one of the largest Catholic websites in the world, dozens of podcasts every week, social media, electronic and print news services, and EWTN publishing. EWTN is the global Catholic network. For more about EWTN, visit EWTN.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Keller, your host. Jimmy Akin is our guest. Lots of folks are on the line with questions because it's open forum this hour. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884. Before I go back to calls, I do want to remind you that we're getting closer to the Catholic Answers Conference. It's the last weekend of September each year, and this is our 8th annual Apologetics Conference. It's titled The Eucharist. I am with you always. A fantastic lineup of speakers. We're going to do the radio show a couple times. There's all kinds of opportunities for socializing and for spiritual growth. We'll have Eucharistic adoration, confessions, masses, and still a great deal on the hotel rooms, just $169 a night at the Hyatt in La Jolla. So you can find out all about it and make your reservations when you're ready to come. CatholicAnswersConference.com. All right, we go now to Ivan in Orange County, California, listening on Catholic.com. Ivan, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, Jimmy. What is your position on the view that early Christian spiritual experiences like the Transfiguration were not genuine spiritual experiences, but rather the result of abusive psychedelic drugs like the Oracle of Delphi, and what evidence do you have to support your position? Thank you.
Okay, so that went by a little fast, but the basic question was, what would I say about the idea that early Christian mystical experiences like the Transfiguration were not genuinely mystical, but were caused by the ingestion of psychedelic substances like the Oracle at Delphi? Okay, well, so the idea that the Oracle at Delphi allegedly was under the influence of a kind of gas. The Oracle at Delphi, the Oracle at Delphi was a kind of prophetess who spoke for the god Apollo. And she, at least when she was doing her professional work, she would be in a cave, she would sit on a tripod, and some of our early sources indicated that there was a kind of vapor or smoke or gas that came up from a crack in the ground that that may have had a psychogenic effect on her and enabled her to have messages from the god Apollo that she would then announce to people. Well, okay, in the sources that speak about this, well, they talk about that. They talk about the gas or the vapor or whatever it was. Now, there's a debate among scholars about, is that part of the story real? And if it was real, that there was a kind of vapor, did the vapor actually have an effect on her, or could it have been something else? Well, in any event, they talk about it. So we have a basis in the Greek sources for saying that the experiences of the Oracle at Delphi may have been connected with this vapor that the sources describe. But when we look at the New Testament and we look at the New Testament, we do not have anything parallel to that. The only substances that are mentioned that Christians ingest are that are associated with the Christian faith are the elements of the Eucharist, which Jesus declares to be his body and blood. And those were, if you don't believe that they're Jesus's body and blood, well, then they're just bread and wine. And yeah, okay, wine is a little psychoactive if you drink enough of it, but Christians weren't getting plastered at the Last Supper. In fact, Paul, or later celebrations of the Eucharist, in fact, Paul in 1 Corinthians rebukes some Corinthians who actually were getting drunk at a church feast. So you weren't supposed to be getting drunk in church, and thus you wouldn't be imbibing enough wine to have a notable psychogenic effect on you. Also, wine is not a hallucinogen. Even when people get drunk, they don't typically have mystical experiences. So we don't have a basis there. When we have other passages that talk about mystical experiences, including the Transfiguration, the disciples are not ingesting anything. It mentions in the account of the Transfiguration that they were on a mountain and there was a cloud that descended, but that's a known natural phenomenon. You know, some mountains are high enough that clouds will, you know, come down on them. I've been on mountains like that myself. So they were just on a high mountain and a cloud showed up, but clouds are not psychoactive. So I don't see a basis in the text there. There was one scholar, his name was John Allegro, back in the 1970s, who published a book called The Sacred Mushroom and the Cross, in which he proposed that Christians were ingesting basically a kind of magic mushroom. But his book has been widely regarded by biblical scholars and historians as nonsense. We just do not have evidence for this. And so if we take the evidence of the New Testament texts themselves and just read them in a straightforward way, they do not indicate that the disciples were ingesting any kind of psychoactive substance that would be responsible for the mystical experiences they had. They present them as mystical experiences, and they don't show Christians doing things like taking mushrooms or potions or things like that in order to induce them.
Ivan, thanks very much for that question. That would be a perfect question for when we do Weird Questions with Jimmy Akin. And if you anybody's got a weird question, you can always send them to us at radio@catholic.com. We collect them up and usually do a couple hours with Jimmy of Weird Questions. Going now to Cincinnati, Ohio, Ethan in Cincinnati watching on YouTube. You are up next, Ethan. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hey, God bless Jimmy Akin and Cy Kellogg.
Thank you, Ethan.
My question for you is something I was talking about with a Muslim, and they were basically saying, okay, if the Holy Spirit's called the Spirit of Truth and it will lead people into all truths and all this kind of stuff, doesn't that imply that there are some truths that the Holy Spirit has that the Father and the Son don't have? Because otherwise, why would it be necessary to send the Holy Spirit? And also, why does the Holy Spirit give certain gifts like wisdom, understanding, counsel, and fortitude, and all that kind of stuff? But does the Father and the Son also?
So the Christian understanding is that in every act that God does outside of the Godhead, so everything that God does in the world, is something that all three persons cooperate in. But they don't all do the same thing. So, for example, in the case of redemption, of our salvation, God the Father sends the Son, and the Son dies on the cross for us to provide the grace we need, and then the Holy Spirit applies that grace to us. So all three persons have a role that they play in salvation, but it's not the same role. They each do different things. In the case of information that the Holy Spirit imparts, well, no, the Holy Spirit does not have information that the Father and the Son don't. On the Christian view, they are all God, and so they are all omniscient, and they each know all truth. And this is, in fact, something that is stressed by St. Paul in his letters to the Corinthians, where he talks about the Spirit of God knows the deep things of God. He knows all God's secrets because he is God. So the Holy Spirit has the same information via omniscience that the Father and the Son do, but God chose to have the Holy Spirit play a role in strengthening the church, in understanding the revelation that Christ had given it. And this is in a way similar to the way prophets work. You know, Muslims will acknowledge that God has sent various prophets over the course of time, and it is certainly not the case that a prophet has information that God doesn't. You know, the prophets have information from God, but God certainly knows what the prophet is going to reveal. And not all prophets reveal the same information. Some prophets say one thing, other prophets reveal something else. So they each reveal a part of what God has chosen to tell us, but they don't all say the same thing. And so even a Muslim should be able to conceptually understand. He may not like it, or he may refuse to believe it, but he should be able, in principle, to acknowledge that the sending of the Holy Spirit to lead us into truth is analogous to God sending a prophet, where the prophet has a certain message that he's going to deliver. God knows what the message is. God sent the person to deliver the message, sent the prophet to deliver the message. In the same way, God knows what the Holy Spirit is going to do with the church, and he sent the Holy Spirit to do it. But that's a general sketch of how I would approach that question. There may have been an auxiliary question you asked. I wanted to make sure, was there an additional part of what you said, or did I cover it all?
Oh, yeah, about for example, the Holy Spirit gives the gifts of the wisdom, understanding, counsel, fortitude. You know what I mean? Does the Father and Son do that as well? Because it seems like in these conversations, you know, we have to make sure it's one will, one power, and all this kind of stuff. And if it seems like we're attributing solely one thing to one person, it seems like it has more importance or more power or anything than the others.
The same principle that I started with applies to the giving of spiritual gifts. All three persons of the Trinity play a role, because this is an action. The giving of spiritual gifts is an act that occurs in the world, and therefore all three persons of the Trinity will play a role in it, but they will play different roles. And the Spirit plays sort of the most direct role in granting these gifts to us.
Ethan, thanks. Lines are full, so I'm going to keep going, but I appreciate the questions. It's open forum today. Jimmy Akin is our guest, and now we go to Denver. Paul, listening on the Alexa in Denver. Glad to have you, Paul. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hey, thanks. God bless you both. Jimmy, I have this question. I've been trying to look over all your mysterious episodes, and I couldn't find my answer to this question. It's a weird question. It's a question regarding the pentacle with the five-pointed star with a circle around it. I understand historically it started around with the Pythagoreans, if I pronounce that right, and then evolved over the centuries into Baha'i, Mormonism, and things like that. So why does the Catholic Church frown upon the pentacle, or any Catholic or Christian wearing a pentacle?
Okay, so you're definitely correct that a pentacle is a five-pointed star inside of a circle. But historical evidence that I'm aware of would not indicate that it goes all the way back to the Pythagoreans. The Pythagoreans were a school of Greek philosophy in the centuries before Christ. And while they were very interested in mathematics and geometry, I'm not aware of any evidence linking the pentacle to them. The evidence that I am aware of, also I'm not aware of Mormons using pentacles, and I think you may have said Baha'is. I don't know whether Baha'is do or not, but Mormons, as far as I'm aware, do not. The evidence I am aware of indicates that the pentacle began to be used in the 1500s. It first appears in certain grimoires, which are kind of magical texts, like the Heptameron and the Key of Solomon. And so it was, from its introduction, associated with unapproved magical practices, and that would lead it to be something that people would tend to want to distance themselves from, because it was associated with unapproved magical stuff. And then subsequently and more recently, It's also been used in the 20th century by the Wiccan movement. It's also been used by Aleister Crowley's Thelema movement, which is another kind of occult sect that was founded by Aleister Crowley. But that would be why Catholics would tend to distance themselves from it. There's nothing wrong with the shape itself. It's just a five-pointed star in a circle, but it is associated with unchristian things like magic and Wicca and Thelema and so forth. And so for a Christian to go around wearing a pentacle would send the wrong message. It would send the idea that I believe in and approve of these non-Christian things when, in fact, you're a Christian. And that would be a mixed message that would mislead people.
Paul, I will thank you for that question and for searching diligently Jimmy Akin's mysterious world for an answer and then coming to us here. You're always welcome here, Paul. I'm going to try to get as many as I can on with Jimmy this hour because lots of calls, of course. Let's go to Johnny in Pennsylvania listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Johnny, are you there with us?
Yes.
Hello, Johnny. Hello. How old are you?
I'm 8 years old.
Well, we're happy to have you here. Go ahead with your question for Mr. Akin.
So I was just wondering, why do things physically have to grow?
Okay. Well, they have to grow because we're talking, I assume, here about life forms like plants and animals. And the reason they have to grow is because their genes make them grow. Inside of our cells, we have a chemical that is known as DNA. And what DNA does is it carries the instructions for how to make our bodies. And all life forms have DNA, at least all life forms here on Earth, whether it's a plant or an animal or a human being, we have DNA in our cells that has the instructions for how to make us. But there's more to say about that, and I'll say it on the other side of the break.
Johnny, can you just hang on for a couple minutes?
Yes.
Okay, good. I'm glad you can. We'll be right back for Jimmy to finish his answer for you about why things grow. More Open Forum right after this.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you. Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Which of the four Gospels can you best relate to?
You can answer that question tomorrow on Take Two with Jerry and Debbie.
On most of these EWTN stations.
Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Johnny, 8 years old, on the line in Pennsylvania, got a little bit of groovy music in the middle of his answer. Johnny called to ask Jimmy why living things have to grow. Johnny, thanks for hanging around. Here's the rest of Mr. Aiken's answer.
Yeah, so we have this chemical in each one of the cells that our body is made out of, and the chemical DNA contains the instructions for how to make us. So in my cells, I have DNA that has instructions for how to make Jimmy Aiken. And in Johnny, in your cells, in your body, you have DNA that has instructions for how to make Johnny. And if you have a carrot, the carrot cells have DNA that it has instructions for how to make a carrot. If you have a dog, the dog has instructions for how to make that dog. And this is common to all life forms. But in order for a kind of life form to not just die out, it needs to develop to the point that it can reproduce itself. So like, you know, Johnny, when you're older, you can get married and then you can have your own children and your line of the family will keep going. If you have a dog, the dog, you know, needs to make puppies. And so the dog needs to get old enough and become big enough and mature enough that it can have puppies. Carrots, similarly, they're plants, but they also need to reproduce. And so the DNA in all of our cells causes our bodies, this is just part of the instructions, it causes our bodies to grow and develop over time so that, among other things, we can reproduce our kind and keep our species going. And that's why things grow, because they need to get to that point where they're big enough and developed enough that they can reproduce and give birth to a new generation.
Okay, Johnny?
I'm sorry, but I feel like I asked the wrong type of question.
What?
I meant to ask, do they grow, not why do they have to?
Oh, I don't. Oh, I misinterpreted it, Johnny.
So why do they grow? I wondered if that might be what you were wondering. So in terms of the mechanics of why do they grow, it again goes back to the DNA. Now every cell in our bodies has internal. They're like little organs. They're called organelles, which just means like little organs. And they have chemical processes that are happening in the cell. We refer to that as metabolism, where it takes in nutrients. So each cell eats, in essence. It has nutrients that it takes in. In the case of humans, it gets those nutrients from our bloodstream. But it takes in oxygen, and it takes in proteins and fats and things like that, glucose, which is a kind of sugar. Actually, it all tends to get turned into glucose. But our cells take in these nutrients and they build them up. And then what they do is at a certain point, the DNA has instructions for once you've got enough nutrients, split in half. And that splitting in half is a process called mitosis. And what will happen is a cell will split in half, and each of the resulting halves is identical to the original cell. And so when you have, let's say, a human baby starts as just a single cell in its mother's body. But then that cell splits and becomes two cells, and then they split and become four cells, and they split and become eight cells, and so on, until they eventually become the trillions of cells that are in an adult human body. And so the actual process of how they grow is by this process of cell splitting, where essentially the cell clones itself. It makes a copy of itself, and that process is known as mitosis.
Johnny, you did a fantastic job, and I'm glad we got you the answer you were looking for. You're always welcome here. Call back whenever you like. And I am going to just keep going, though, Johnny, because I got every other line full. So on we go. Cyrus in Virginia Beach, Virginia, watching on Twitch. Hi, Cyrus. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi. I watched your episode on Exodus, and I saw how you tried to elaborate on how the seven plagues of Egypt could be explained by natural phenomenon. And I was wondering why we don't apply some of the same reasoning to the Marian apparitions. When I watched your episode, I noticed I came away with the understanding God can work through his creation naturally to manifest his will. When I see a lot of Marian apparitions, I feel like I have the opposite conclusion, that because it's so unnatural, it is now a candidate for being a miracle. So that's something I struggled with. Wasn't sure if you had anything to say about that.
Yeah, so God can work through his creation in a way that he uses a natural phenomenon to accomplish an effect, but he arranges for it providentially to happen at a certain time. And so from the perspective of faith, we can say, oh, wow, this happened just now. God must have caused that. That's a miracle. It's not the same kind of miracle, though, where God interrupts or supplements the ordinary functioning of nature, like Jesus' resurrection from the dead. That's a different kind of miracle that's even more amazing. So in the case of the Exodus, if God used the natural agricultural cycle in Egypt to produce the 10 plagues, which is something I talked about in an episode of Mysterious World on the Exodus, it could be that God just used really intense weather to cause the 10 plagues to occur at the time they needed to occur in order for Pharaoh to let the Israelites go. So that would have been what you could call a type 1 miracle, where God uses things in nature that do ordinarily occur, but he arranges for them to occur just when they're needed to produce some effect. On the other hand, people do not, after 3 days, rise from the dead. So that would be a different type of miracle that's even more amazing. You could call Jesus's resurrection a type 2 miracle. So what do we find when we look at Marian apparitions? Well, in some cases, there may be a miracle of either type 1 or type 2. In the case of Fatima, for example, Fatima is famous for the miracle of the sun, where people in Portugal seem to see the sun dance or spin in the sky. And there have been attempts. I talk about this in episode 40 of Mysterious World. You can get to it by going to mysterious.fm/40, the number 40. There have been people like Father Stanley Yockey who have proposed a kind of atmospheric phenomenon that does occur in nature, that God could have had providentially occur right then to explain at least part of what people saw when they witnessed the miracle of the sun. So there are situations with Marian apparitions where you might encounter what we could call type 1 miracles of God working through nature rather than supplementing or overriding nature.
Cyrus, all make sense?
Oh, yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank
God
you.
Bless. I'm halfway through your episode on Akita. Very good so far.
Thank you.
And by the way, that's an episode on Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World. So that if folks want that, they can go to Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World and find the Akita episode. I'm going to go. Thank you again, Cyrus. Let's go to Aaron in Hastings, Michigan, watching on YouTube. Hi, Aaron.
Hi. I know I've asked this question before. Mm-hmm. But I still cannot grasp it. I don't know why.
Well, let's have another go at it then.
How is it that Catholics can believe in the three main theories, like the one that's in the Bible, the 7 days of creation, evolution, and the Big Bang? Because from my understanding of evolution and the Big Bang, they take away God.
Okay. Well, that's not the Catholic understanding. The Catholic understanding would be that God caused the Big Bang, and that he then caused the development of life forms through evolution. So the Catholic understanding would be that God caused the creation of the universe, and then he caused the universe to unfold in a certain way that led to the development of life forms and eventually human beings. And so there are people who want to cut God out of the picture and say there is no God, but that is not something that's intrinsic. It's not part and parcel of either the Big Bang or evolution. In fact, the gentleman who is credited with coming up with the Big Bang Theory, was a Catholic priest. He was from Belgium. His name was Father Georges Lemaître. And he was a priest and an astronomer, and he looked at the evidence from astronomy and said, you know, it looks like the universe had a beginning where everything was originally compressed into a single point and then it expanded. But he regarded that as something that God did, and subsequent Catholics have as well. In terms of the 7 days, there are different ways that people have sought to harmonize the 7 days with the findings of science. The way that the Catholic Church views them in the Catechism is to say that they symbolically represent the work of the Creator as a succession of 6 days followed by a 7th day of rest. So the Catechism says God really did do all this stuff. He really did make the sun. He really did make the land. He really did make the day and the night. But these things that God really did do have been symbolically presented as if they occurred in the space of a Hebrew week, you know, just a 7-day period. And there are indications in the text that it's meant to be understood symbolically, because God sets up the day-night cycle on day one. Well, the ancients knew just as well as we do that it's the light that comes from the sun that makes it day. And yet in Genesis 1, the sun isn't created until day 4. And so you have ancient authors like, for example, St. Augustine saying these must not be regular days. They must be something other than regular days, because you couldn't have a day-night cycle without the sun on the first 3 days. So they must be something else. And the way the Catholic Church today looks at them is that they are a symbol that conveys the essence of what God did, but it compresses it into the framework of a Hebrew week.
Aaron, okay. Go ahead, Aaron. Go ahead.
And I was also wondering, where can I find that at in the Catechism?
It's in the section, it's in part one, which is the section on the creation of, tell you what, we're going to need to take a break. I'll come back and have the exact paragraph number for you.
Hang on, Aaron. We'll do that break. Be right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, this is Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione of San Francisco. Keep your dial tuned to Catholic Answers Live.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
One time somebody said to me, why don't you air these people? And I said, no, because I don't think they're Catholic. He says, by what right do you have to say that? I said, I own the network.
Mother Angelica Live Classics, every morning, 2 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Aaron on the line in Hastings, Michigan, watching on YouTube with a question about creation and how Catholics can reconcile the biblical accounts of creation and the current scientific accounts. And Jimmy, you wanted to get, he asked for a particular passage in the Catechism.
Yeah, the one that deals with the, and I had the two numbers in my head, but I wasn't sure which went with which passage. There are two passages in the Catechism that kind of cover this from different angles. Paragraph 337 in the Catechism talks about the 7 days of creation. And I was giving a near quotation of it before about a succession of 6 days. It talks about them being symbolic. The other paragraph that you want to look at is paragraph 283. And that one expresses appreciation for the work that scientists have done in investigating the age and dimensions of the cosmos and the emergence of life form. So they don't use the words Big Bang and the words evolution, but that's what they're talking about. The age and dimensions of the cosmos refers to astronomical discoveries, including the Big Bang, which, you know, occurred around 13.8 billion years ago. So that tells us the age of the universe. And then the emergence of life forms is another way of saying evolution.
Aaron, thanks. You did give me a chance to pitch our podcast, Catholic Answers Focus, so I'm going to do that real quick. If this is something that you'd like to hear more about, Dr. Karen Oberg, an astrophysicist at Harvard who also teaches Aquinas, she did a program with us one time, Does the Big Bang Prove God? You'll actually be surprised by her answer, I think, but it's very insightful from the position of a scientist at Harvard and a Catholic woman. So you can get that just by going to if you just put in Catholic Answers, Karen Oberg, it's the first thing that comes up, at least in my search engine. So Catholic Answers, Karen Oberg, and Does the Big Bang Prove God? Going to Ottawa, Canada now. Daniel in Ottawa, Canada, watching on YouTube. You are up next, Daniel. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, Jimmy and Cy. I really appreciate your show.
Thank you, Daniel.
So I just had a quick question about fasting. I've been using it for health reasons. It's been going well.
Good.
But I've been trying to figure out how it fits into my faith life. So I'm reading some Thomas Aquinas, and he said, fasting can help against gluttony. Totally agree with that. That's helpful. But the thing that I have more issues with is how it fits in with my prayer life, because I find when I fast, it's actually harder to pray. You know, I'm either distracted by hunger pangs, or it seems to make it more difficult to pray. So I just wanted to hear your thoughts about that, Jimmy, since I know you have some experience with that. So
based on what you're telling me, I'm guessing that you don't fast all the time. Like, you don't do a one meal a day every day. You kind of have shorter periods, or you have periods of fasting, but they're not constant. Is that correct?
Well, I'm just starting up, and I'm doing intermittent fasting. And I did a 2-day fast at one point. It was stressful, kind of difficult on the body, but it's effective. So
here's what I can tell you. When you encounter those difficulties, it has, and you have, say, hunger, and you're trying to pray, and the hunger is a distraction. Well, it has spiritual value to push through in those situations, to just do your best to keep praying and not focus on the hunger. And that has spiritual value in itself, because you're persevering in a spiritual practice, even though it's more difficult than it would otherwise be, because you've got this hunger. So that itself adds a spiritual dimension to it that sort of intensifies the effect of the prayer. On the other hand, this will not happen if you persist in a particular regimen of fasting. That will not keep happening. So monks historically have fasted on one meal a day, and then on Sundays they would have two meals. And on, like, holy days, they would have two meals. And they're not hungry every day, because it turns out that hunger is almost all habit. Your body will make you hungry when you are used to eating, because it figures, oh, it's this time of day, that's when food is available, we better turn on the hunger signal so he'll remember to eat now while the food is still available. And so that's why we get hungry at certain times of day. It's because that's when we're used to eating. And so if you set a different eating regimen for yourself, you simply won't be hungry at other times of day, once your body gets used to the current eating regimen. And so, like, I eat one meal a day in the evenings, and as a result, I'm not hungry all day. I get hungry when it's time to eat. I may experience brief just a little bit of hunger for like 20 minutes in the day as my body has finished digesting last night's meal and now it's switching over into burning fat. But really, hunger is a matter of habit. And once you retrain your body to a new eating regimen, you'll only get hungry, or you'll only get significantly hungry at the times when you now are eating. So if you shift your fasting schedule around, or if you don't do it all the time, you may have some hunger, but that is, that itself will add to the spiritual quality in a way of, or the spiritual punch of your prayer, because by continuing to pray and ignoring the hunger, that has spiritual value. On the other hand, if you set an eating plan and you stick to it, within a few days or a week or two at the most, your body will be used to the new eating plan and you won't be experiencing significant hunger except at the times when you normally eat.
Daniel, going to leave it there. I hope that was helpful to you. Still lots of folks on the line. It's open forum. Jimmy Akin is our guest. So come right back here to California. Ryan in California watching on YouTube. Go ahead, Ryan, with your question for Jimmy.
Hello. So my question is, so it's traditionally held that Jesus died on a Friday. My question is in part, why do we then celebrate Easter on a Sunday, when if you were to count up 3 days from that Friday, it would lead you to Monday? And then also, as another part to that question, why do we refer to it as Easter? Because I've heard from some people that Easter is named after a pagan god. So why do we refer it to that instead of Resurrection Day?
Okay. In regard to the first question, in the ancient world, they frequently counted wholes for parts. They had a different way of counting than we do. So the 3 days that Christ are in the tomb are the part of Friday after he died on the cross, all of Saturday, and then the part of Sunday before the empty tomb was found. So those are the 3 days. It's part of Friday, all of Saturday, and part of Sunday. But in the ancient world, that was, since you've got a day and parts of two other days, they counted that as 3 days. It was a different way of counting than we use. And so the New Testament indicates very clearly, it's not just tradition, it's actually in the Gospels. In fact, all four of the Gospels indicate that Jesus was crucified on what was called the Day of Preparation. The Day of Preparation was the day you did all your business so that you could rest on the Sabbath. So the Sabbath is Saturday. The Day of Preparation was Friday. All four of the Gospels say Jesus was crucified on Friday. Also, all four of the Gospels say that Jesus rose from the dead on the first day of the week, or Sunday. So that tells us how we need to count all of this. It's in accord with the ancient practice of counting parts for wholes. In terms of why we call it Easter, well, that's just the way English grew up. In other languages, it is not called Easter. Now, there is one and only one early source that suggests that Easter is named after a pagan goddess called Eostre. That one source is the Venerable Bede, who is an English historian in like the 800s. And he says that 200 years before his time, there was this goddess called, that pagans worshiped, called Eostre. But nobody worshiped her in his time. And he's the only source that refers to this goddess. And he's not talking about his own time. He's talking about centuries earlier. So he may just be wrong about that. The evidence that Easter comes from a pagan goddess is actually quite weak. But that's just English. In other languages, the name for Easter is based on the Hebrew word Pesach, which is the Hebrew word for Passover, because that's when Jesus died and rose from the dead. It was at Passover. And so the name for Easter in other languages tends to be Pasche or Pasch or Pesage or things like that, which are all based on the word for Passover. English is just weird, and that's just how the language grew up.
And how does that sit with you, Ryan?
That's perfect. Thank you.
All right. It did sound perfect, didn't it? Thank you very, very much. Jimmy, I think I'll just encourage folks to hang on. If you've got more, there are more folks with questions. There's one line open right now, and Mark Brumley will be here the next hour. So give a call if you'd like to get in the queue, 888-318-7884. I want to tell us again, we've got a few seconds for you, if you want to tell us again what's on Jimmy Akin's Mysterious World tomorrow.
Well, we're going to be talking about the secret teachings of the school of Jewish mysticism known as Kabbalah. And they're not secret these days, but they allegedly were secret for a long time, and they are really strange. They have some really weird ideas about God and the afterlife and the origin of evil, and it should be very eye-opening for people.
And this is the same one that you hear celebrities like I remember Madonna.
Madonna, was, Ariana Grande, yeah.
Oh, Ariana Grande's a what's a practitioner of Kabbalah called?
In Hebrew they're called a mukabbalah, but in English we would say a Kabbalist.
Ah, yeah. All right, Jimmy, thanks very, very much.
My pleasure.
As I said, Mark Brumley, president of Ignatius Press, will be here in just a few minutes. So if you're on the line, hang on the line. If you haven't dialed yet, we do have a couple of lines open for you. 888-318-7884. We'll continue with Open Forum, so you're welcome to ask any question you want of Mark Brumley right after this on Catholic Answers Live. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I'm Cy Kellett, your host, and we continue with Open Forum. Probably a little bit of groovy music. Open Forum means open to anyone. The show is called Catholic Answers Live, but anyone can call, whether you're Catholic or not, whether you're Christian or not. You are very welcome here. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884, and whatever your question is, that is welcome as well. Maybe you have general questions about God, about morality, about a philosophical point. Those are welcome. Maybe you have more specific questions about the person of Jesus or the Bible. Or maybe even more specific, you have questions about the sacraments of the Catholic Church or the dogmas and doctrines around popes and the Virgin Mary and all that. It's all welcome, and I often forget to take the time to remind people that all those questions are welcome. We love talking about this stuff, and you don't have to have any qualification to call. You certainly don't have to pass any religious test, and you could be advanced or you could be an absolute beginner. Never have asked this question before or maybe even thought of it. 888-318-7884. I want to just give a little note about tomorrow's program. We have, I don't know if the neglected is the right word, but it would be probably an enhancement for the show if we had more women religious on. And tomorrow we will have a wonderful woman religious on talking about why be a woman religious. So girls and young women in particular, that might be of interest tomorrow. And maybe you want to think of a question and you can call and we'll have those conversations tomorrow. Again, the number here, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Right now, I gotta continue to promote the conference too a little bit, and I'll be honest with you. The conference is coming up, and we have this great deal on room rates of just $169 a night. It's September 22nd through the 25th, and I don't think I've been promoting it maybe enough because we still have quite a few spots open. I mean, it's already going to be we have 1,000 spots basically, and I know we're somewhere in the neighborhood of 700, and we'd really love you to come. So if you're nearby and it's convenient for you, or maybe if you have time to plan travel, even if you want to come from somewhere else farther afield, just head to CatholicAnswersConference.com. There's going to be a couple of special events, including a beautiful evening concert of Gregorian chant and similarly uplifting music. CatholicAnswersConference.com. Bishop Thomas Papraki will be our guest from Springfield, Illinois. The full conference ticket includes the banquet dinner with Bishop Papraki and his keynote address, and there'll just be a lot of time for socializing, hanging out, having a good time. Go to CatholicAnswersConference.com. We got Mark Brumley this hour. Mark Brumley is president of Ignatius Press. Ignatius Press, of course, one of the most important, maybe the most important publisher in the Alpha Quadrant, but I think we have a slight technical problem, so Jimmy's going to come back and help us out a little bit. So I don't know if you were particularly calling for Mark, but here we've got Jimmy Akin with us. Jimmy, thanks for coming back and helping us out for a minute.
Pleasure.
While we get Mark on the line, maybe we'll just head right back to the phones if you want to go back to work. All right.
Okay.
Let's go to Lewis in Ohio, listening on 94.5 FM. Lewis, thank you for waiting through the break. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi. So I was recently challenged by a Protestant on why the sacraments are necessary. They see them as more of Old Testament rituals and traditions that are done in order to be saved. They even quoted Jesus on the cross saying, "It is finished," meaning, you know, there's nothing else that really needs to be done in order to be saved. I am Catholic. I practice the sacraments. I receive the Eucharist, I go to confession, and I feel closer after practicing the sacraments. So I guess I understand from a spiritual standpoint why I do them, because I do feel closer to God. But how can I explain to them exactly why we practice the sacraments and allow them to see it through a non, Old Testament lens, for lack of a better term?
Okay.
that will kind of help them understand why we do what we do. And I'm just going to hang up the phone and listen and let you guys respond.
Well,
thanks.
Don't hang up yet. So the first thing I'd say is that your friend is reading into the text, because when Jesus says it is finished, the person is interpreting that to mean nobody needs to do anything now. And that's not what Jesus said. He said, it is finished. So what is the it that is finished? Well, his work is finished, but that doesn't mean that we don't need to do anything. Obviously, we do need to do some stuff. We need to respond to him, and we need to do the things that we're told we need to do in order to be saved, like repent of our sins and believe in Jesus. And there's a third thing that we're told that's a standard part of early Christian preaching. We need to be baptized. If you look at the different documents in the New Testament, they don't mention all three of them all the time, but the three things that are consistently associated with being saved and becoming a Christian are repentance, faith, and baptism. And we have multiple passages indicating that we receive grace through baptism. In fact, 1 Peter 3:21 says, baptism now saves you. So your friend might want to think about that. This is not just a symbol. Peter flat out says, baptism now saves you. And we have other passages indicating that we're buried with Christ in baptism and we rise with him to new life, so we receive new life in baptism. It really does something. Now, in terms of why does it do something, why does God have sacraments at all, it's because of the kind of beings we are. If we were angels, if we were just created intellects, then God wouldn't have given us sacraments because we wouldn't have bodies to do the sacraments with. But we're not angels. We're human beings. We have a spirit that enables us to relate to God, but we also have bodies, and it's through our bodies that we primarily interact with the world. And so it helps us to have visible, tangible signs of God's grace, and that's why you feel closer to God when you perform the sacraments, because you're a being that relies on senses and having a tangible sign of God's grace to give you the assurance that you're receiving God's grace. All of that helps you out, and so that's why God did this. It's also why God did the same thing, or something similar in any event, for Jewish people in the Old Testament, because it falls directly out of human nature. As beings that are both physical and spiritual, it is natural for God to reach us by using a physical, visible means to give us his invisible spiritual grace. So that's what I have to say as an overview on that subject. I think that you and your friend might benefit from a little short booklet that I wrote called The Words of Eternal Life. So, Cy, if we could send Lewis a copy of Words of Eternal Life, that might help out him and his friend.
Well, we'll try. Lewis did not take your advice. I don't think he listened. He just hung up really quick. So, Lewis, give us a call back, and we'll send you that book. We'll be happy to. Just give us a call, and we'll get your information, and we'll send it off to you. Jimmy Akin is our guest now. And that's a great relief. Thanks for helping us out here, Jimmy. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back with more Open Forum on Catholic Answers Live.
Let us help you with your question today on Catholic Answers Live.
Do you have a question but prefer to ask it privately? Catholic Questions can help. Go to CatholicQuestions.com to ask your question online, email us, drop us a letter, or give us a call. Longtime Catholic Answers Live apologist and author Jim Blackburn or another Catholic Questions apologist will be happy to assist you. Catholic Questions proudly supports Catholic Answers Live, so visit us at CatholicQuestions.com today. That's CatholicQuestions.com.
He was a doctor of the church and one of the greatest defenders of Christ's divinity.
Matthew Bunsen and the Doctors of the Church.
Saint Athanasius of Alexandria fought against the Arian heresy that questioned the divinity of Christ. He once condemned the Arians as opposers of Christ who had dug a pit of ungodliness. It was said of him, Athanasius contra mundum, Athanasius against the world, but for Christ. He died in 373.
For more about the Doctors of the Church, visit doctorsofthechurch.com.
Jimmy Akins, our guest now, is the most important apologist in the Alpha Quadrant, so we're glad that he's here. The number to call, 888-318-7884. I have no idea why I started saying that about Mark Brumley.
I'm not the most important publisher in the Alpha Quadrant.
No,
though.
That's right.
That would be Mark Brumley.
Yep, he certainly is. Open forum means ask whatever question you like. Jimmy Akin will stay here for the hour and answer all questions that come in, as long as we got time to get to them. And we go now, if I'm in the right order, to Mark in Las Vegas, Nevada, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius XM Satellite Radio. Hi, Mark. Got a question for Jimmy?
Hi, happy to talk to you. So my question is, when does religious truth or faith, can it ever be constituted as a fact? I got middle school students, you know, we're talking about facts and beliefs and, you know, and somebody said, Jesus loves you, and that's a fact. Then some people will argue, you know, that's a belief. Or maybe even the resurrection, they would ask, you know, is the resurrection a fact? Or, you know, we believe that as, you know, with historical evidence, but what if I don't believe that even as a source, you know, the source that we get that from? Anyway, when is a religious belief or truth can ever be considered as fact?
Okay, so the terms truth, fact, and belief can be used in different ways. And according to a very common way of using the term truth, it means the same thing as fact. So if I say it's true that it's raining outside, I could say the same thing by saying it's a fact that it's raining outside. A fact is simply something that is true. And then beliefs also can point to facts. I can say it's raining outside, and I believe that it's raining outside. So we believe in truths or facts. And so that's a very common way of using these terms. On the other hand, they can be used in other ways. For example, someone might use the term fact to mean provable fact, something that you can show a lot of evidence for, and they might use belief to refer to something that you believe to be true, but you don't have proof that it's true. Well, I would say fundamentally, we don't need to be, quibbling about these different uses of the terms, because we can translate between them. And when someone says Jesus loves you, and that's a fact, that means it's true that Jesus believes you. Can I prove that? Well, that's going to depend to whose satisfaction. I can show that the Bible talks about Jesus loving us. You know, St. Paul says that Jesus loved me and gave himself for me, and Paul is not unique, so that's going to be true of all of us. But someone may not accept the Bible. And so if they believe in the Bible, then I can prove it to them. But if they don't believe in the Bible, well, then I can't prove it to them, with at least not without doing more work. What I could then do is give them evidence for the Bible being true. And that's what the whole work of apologetics is about, or at least part of what apologetics is about. So I would say that that something like Jesus loves you is true. It is not merely a belief. It is something that is actually true. So is the resurrection. So are other truths that are contained in the Bible. And we can then show, either from the Bible, that these things are true, or we can provide evidence that the Bible is reliable and that we can trust the Bible when it tells us these things. So whether you want to call something a belief or a fact or a truth, it is going to be up to you to decide. It's going to be up to the individual person to decide the exact nuances that they're going to be using for those words. But there is a meaningful sense in which I can say things like Jesus loves you, and that's a fact. Whether I can convince you of it is a different question. Also, since we're talking about kids and really more generally, when we interpret the Bible, of course, we have to interpret it correctly. And in order to do that, we need to recognize that it does have symbols in it and so forth. And we need to take that into account when we interpret it. And we need to make sure we're listening to the magisterium and so forth as we interpret Scripture. But correctly interpreted, the Bible will tell us things that are true, and we can therefore accept them as facts.
And I'm going to leave that there, Mark. Thank you very, very much for that question. Going to go now to Pace right here in California, watching on YouTube. Pace, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hey, guys. It's wonderful to speak to you this afternoon. My question is the phrase extra ecclesiam nulla salus, meaning in Latin, there's no salvation outside the church, still a usable phrase after the Second Vatican Council?
Well, sure, it can still be used. The Catechism uses it. So, you know, the Catechism contains extra ecclesiam nulla salus. It can still be used, but it needs to be used with caution, because the phrase is open to misunderstanding, especially today. And so I wouldn't just go to someone and say extra ecclesiam nulla salus, or there is no salvation outside the church, and stop there. Because there has been doctrinal development on this question, I would need to go further. And if I'm going to use that phrase, I would need to go further and explain what it does and doesn't mean. But the phrase itself can be used, as illustrated by the fact it's in the Catechism.
That's satisfying to you, Pace?
Yeah, perfect. Thank you very much. I appreciate it, Jimmy.
All right. Thank you, Pace. Boy, we are moving right along here. Off we go now to South Carolina. Irene is listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Irene, thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Thank you for taking my call. I am a practicing Catholic. My husband would describe himself as a materialist. And over the years, he's expressed an interest in owning a set of tarot cards, primarily for their artistic and historical interest or novelty. I have a very strong negative reaction to this, primarily because I've been told to avoid the accessories of the occult kind of at all costs, particularly the concept of spiritual oppression being attached to these items. But listening to you, Jimmy, makes me wonder if this perspective doesn't sort of fall into superstition. And I'm wondering if it's a reasonable thing to say no, you know, within the context of faith and reason, or if this is something that I should reconsider.
Well, if you don't want to have tarot cards around, you don't have to have tarot cards around. But I wouldn't give a hard no on this, because tarot cards are just cards. Originally, they were used to play card games. In fact, you can use tarot cards. It's just a deck of cards. You can use them to play card games now, just like you could use a regular 52 bicycle deck to play card games, or you could use an Uno deck to play Uno. So tarot originally was just a set of cards, and people would play games with them. And eventually, a few centuries ago, people started using them to fortune tell, but there's nothing intrinsically occult about the cards themselves. So if you like the art on a particular deck of cards and you want them for artistic purposes, or you could have them for artistic purposes, just like if you like, you know, there are a bunch of different types of regular 52 playing card decks. I mentioned Bicycle, which is a company that manufactures the most commonly used ones, but there are others as well. Some of them have special artistic properties. If you liked a regular 52 card deck, and because of its art, you could get that for artistic reasons. If you want to play card games with them, that's fine too. You don't want to be trying to use them to foretell the future, but in terms of just having them, there's nothing here to really there's nothing wrong with that in principle. And to think that just because some people use this deck for fortune telling makes it prohibited for me to have, I would say I want to be gentle about it, but I would say that there is a risk of that being a little superstition, meaning attributing more significance to something than it actually has.
Irene?
That's a perfect answer, and I thought you would say that. Thank you so much.
Irene,
no problem.
It's striking to hear how you asked that question. Very, very interesting. I'd love to send you a copy of Jimmy's book, The Words of Eternal Life. Maybe there's somebody in your, life that would like to take a look at that book sometime. So you might want to have it on your library.
I thought you were going to say you were going to send her a deck of tarot cards, but
no,
okay.
I cannot do that. No, I don't have any. We don't have the Catholic Answers tarot cards. I can assure you of that. Oh, that's going to go viral. Somebody's going to cut that out and put that somewhere. All right, Irene, it was delightful talking with you. I hope we'll get to talk again, but hang on. We'll get your information. We'll send you a copy of The Words of Eternal Life, True Happiness and Where to Find It. I'm going to go to Chicago now. Dave in Chicago, Illinois, watching on YouTube. You're up next, Dave. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy Akin.
Well, good evening. Was wondering about binding and loosing, right? First, bad authority given to Peter in Matthew 16, and then to the disciples in Matthew 18. I mean, we go with the fact that that's passed on, right? Like an apostolic succession. But if there's unbound, like unconstrained authority given to the successors, you know, popes and bishops down the line to bind and loose, don't we get into doctrinal trouble sometimes, or the ability to get into doctrinal trouble? I mean, even recently, right? In February, you know, Pope Francis says, blasphemers and apostates are part of the communion of saints. Like, really?
Well, I don't know where Francis said that. So I don't know if that's true or not.
February 2nd address. Yeah.
I'd have to see the
audience of February 2nd.
I'd have to see the context and the exact words he used. I can see senses in which that's true, because as soon as someone is baptized, they are consecrated to God, and baptism imparts a mark on your soul that can never be removed. And if a person then starts blaspheming or apostatizes from the faith, they are still objectively baptized. They're still objectively a Christian, no matter what they call themselves or what sins they're engaged in. So if that's what he meant, well, then he meant something that's true. On the other hand, binding and loosing really doesn't directly interact with that question. Binding and loosing is a term that was used in first century Judaism. I mean, it can be used to mean other things too, but in first century Judaism, it was used to mean the ability to make or modify or remove regulations for the life of the community. But it was not an unlimited power. Jesus gave Peter the power to bind and loose. He later shared it more broadly with the disciples. But if you went to St. Peter and said, "So Peter, Jesus gave you the authority to bind and loose. Does that mean you could make adultery okay? Or murder okay? Or theft okay?" Peter would have said, "Absolutely not. I can't loose those things. Those are in the Ten Commandments." So this is not an unlimited authority. It's within the limits of what God allows. Properly speaking, there is a difference. I'm going to use a technical term here, but there's a difference between God's eternal moral law and what's called merely ecclesiastical law, which deals with how you implement God, moral principles in a concrete context in the church. And the power to bind and loose has to do with the ability to make and abolish merely ecclesiastical laws, like you need to be such and such an age in order to get confirmed. That's not something that's a matter of divine law. People can get confirmed at any age as a matter of divine law. But in some parishes and some countries and some dioceses, they will have an age where they do it. And that age, since it's not part of divine law, is part of merely ecclesiastical law. And that's the kind of thing that can be instituted or modified or abolished. But the sacrament of confirmation itself is part of God's law, and therefore it can't be abolished. The church doesn't have the ability to say, oh, we're never going to confirm anybody again. The sacrament of confirmation is hereby abolished. So there are limits to the authority of binding and loosing.
Dave, appreciate the question. I hope that that was helpful to you. It's open forum today on Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin, our guest this hour, ready to take whatever question you have. You're welcome to pick up the phone and call 888-318-7884. As lines become available, we'll do our very best to get you on with Jimmy. 888-318-7884. More open forum with Jimmy Akin right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live.
Can you defend the Church's teaching on the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist? Do you desire a deeper relationship with our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament? Join us September 22nd through 25th for the annual Catholic Answers Conference in San Diego. This year's theme is the Eucharist, I am with you always. Featuring all the Catholic Answers speakers and special guest Bishop Thomas Papracki, use promo code EARLY to save $50 when you register at CatholicAnswersConference.com.
Want to know more about the origins of the Catholic Church? Joe Heschmeyer explores the beginnings of Christianity. In the early church was the Catholic Church. Joe digs deep into the words and actions of those who lived right after the apostles to refute anti-Catholic claims of how the faith was lived back then. Order your copy of The Early Church Was the Catholic Church today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Which of the four Gospels can you best relate to?
You can answer that question tomorrow on Take Two with Jerry and Debbie.
On most of these EWTN stations.
Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live, open forum. It's Thursday, so there's a little groovy music there for you. Jimmy Akin, our guest. If you were here at the beginning, you know that Jimmy graciously agreed to do an extra hour with us because we had a little technical problem with our scheduled guests, and that's an awful good deal when your backup is Jimmy Akin. So lots of folks on the line. We'll get right back to those calls. I believe next is Joe in Pennsylvania, listening on the EWTN app. Joe, we're glad you're here. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, how you doing?
Very well, thank you.
I have a question. Oh, good.
Okay.
I have a question regarding a Vatican II council.
Okay.
I know a lot of things changed. What was the reasoning behind their decision not to indict the Jews for the death of Jesus Christ after the, during, I mean, before. I know it was like a common thing that they kind of landed on the Jews before the Vatican II, but afterwards it wasn't really a thing, I guess you can say.
Well, the reason that Vatican II stressed that Jewish people today are not guilty of the death of Christ is because they didn't kill him. And they're just not guilty of killing Jesus, and so they wanted to make that clear. It's not even true that all Jews in Jesus' own day were responsible for his death on the cross, because the disciples were Jews. Now, there's a sense in which all human beings are responsible for the death of Christ because he died for our sins, but in terms of who's guilty of causing it on the human level, only certain Jews and Romans were responsible, and it would be irresponsible to accuse Jewish people as a whole or Roman people as a whole of being Christ killers, because most of them aren't. And so there have been distortions of Christian teaching, anti-Semitic ones down through the course of history, where you would have Christians saying Jews are Christ killers and things like that. But just no, they're not. The Jews who are alive today and for the last 2,000 years did not kill Christ. There were millions of Jews in the first century Roman world, and the vast majority of those millions did not have any role in killing Jesus Christ. And so what you could call a hasty generalization or a sweeping generalization, but it's a logical fallacy to accuse all Jews of doing something that they simply did not do.
Now, that seems very clear, but this is also a very important question, Joe. So does that seem clear to you?
It does. I just want to know, how did the Vatican II transform their decision? What was there in their decision to change that? What made them change their...
Well, okay, a couple of things. Number one, so this is not something, this understanding of the Jewish people is not something new. There were Catholics, prior to the Second Vatican Council who understood this full well. Pius XII, for example, famously said during the Nazi Holocaust and the persecution of Jewish people by the Nazis that preceded the Holocaust, he said, "We are all spiritually Semites." So he identified everybody that way. He understood that Jewish people were not responsible for the death of Christ, and he hid Jewish people in the Vatican and in other religious properties in Italy to keep them safe from the Nazis. So there were Catholics prior to Vatican II that understood this full well, and then the Holocaust happened. And the Holocaust was a major traumatic event in European history that focused largely, not exclusively, but largely on the Jewish people. And after World War II, there was a big desire on the part of the church to do a couple things. One of them was a general desire to take a new tone and establish friendly relations with people who are not Christian and not Catholic, which is why the Second Vatican Council took the approach it did in addressing a lot of groups, but in particular, because of the history of anti-Semitism and because of the recent historical experience of the Holocaust, there was a strong desire on the part of the Council Fathers to make the point that Jewish people today are not responsible for the death of Jesus, and it is unjust to treat them as if they were. And that's a message that some people needed to hear, because there were Christian anti-Semites, and there were people who had just killed millions of Jewish people. The church felt it was an appropriate time to say, no, this is not the case. Stop it.
Joe, thank you very, very much. Appreciate that call and that question. I'm going to go now to Joseph in California, listening on Catholic.com. Glad you're here, Joseph. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi, Jimmy. Thanks for picking up. My questions revolve a bit around poverty today. Mm-hmm. So my question lies in, if there's a person who is starving and, for example, might die, and you know this for a fact, he would be morally responsible in feeding them, of course. Now, my question is...
all things being equal, yeah.
Yeah. It would seem that, you know, since there's always someone in dire need of housing or food or something, you know, it would seem as though you would never be morally justified in almost buying anything, you know, but out of pleasure or anything besides, you know, your own survival, which seems like an absurd conclusion, but I struggle kind of with the logical formalism behind the why this might not be the case.
Okay. There are a couple of reasons. I think a helpful frame of reference is the fact this isn't just true now. This is true of all of human history. And yet, at the Last Supper, at the anointing of Jesus, there were people who said, ooh, we could have sold this expensive ointment and used it to feed the poor. And Jesus said, the poor you will always have with you. You can help them anytime you want. You're not always going to have me with you. And this was actually a good thing to do. So Jesus indicated that there are values that can transcend helping the poor. It is important to help the poor, but there are values that transcend it. And one of them is living a normal human life, what theologians would refer to as living in modo humano, in living in a human way. Now, some people are called to extreme sacrifice in their lives. And if someone has been called to live a form of extreme sacrifice, then that involves helping the poor, then they would need to do more than a normal person. But a normal person needs to care for themselves and care for their family and not constantly be in a state of stress and panic about the problems in the world. There's only so much that we as individuals can take on. I, as an individual, cannot solve all of the problems in the world. Even if I tried, I would fail. And I would hurt myself in the process. And by hurting myself, I would actually diminish the amount of good that I'm able to do in the world. So I need to take care of myself. I need to take care of my own needs in addition to trying to help other people. And we see examples of this in the Gospels themselves, where there were lots of sick people in Israel, but Jesus didn't go healing sick people every single day. He would do things like take the disciples apart and go to a remote place where they wouldn't be bugged, or at least where they were hoping they wouldn't be bugged, so they could spend time alone, taking care of their own needs and doing other things. And that was a form of them taking care of themselves. So yes, we do need to do what we can to address the problems in the world, whether it's poverty or something else, but we fundamentally are called to live in a human mode. Most of us are not called to live lives of extreme sacrifice, and if we tried to live lives of extreme sacrifice, we would end up hurting ourselves and doing less good. So that's the fundamental kind of sketch of the situation that I would give. Is that of assistance?
Joseph?
Okay, you know, that makes complete sense. So would you say the same thing applies, I guess, with like when it comes to buying from corporations and such? Because, you know, a lot of companies, you know, like Nike and stuff like that, you know, they might use things such as sweatshops or that kind of thing. So
If you never do business with a sinner, you're not going to do business with anybody, because everybody is a sinner.
Yeah.
And so one wants to use one's influence when one can, in a reasonable way, to encourage improvement. But we should not be thinking in terms of hard lines of these people might be doing something wrong, therefore I can't do business with them, because that's true of every single business in the world. All of them employ sinners. Someone is going to do something wrong with the money you give them, no matter who it is. So we simply should not be thinking in those terms, because it will hurt ourselves if we do. We're going to be scrupulous and tortured and under stress, and we're not going to be able to do the good that we could do if we didn't try to take responsibility for everything everybody else does.
Thank you, Joseph. Got to take a quick break. Right back with more Open Forum with Jimmy Akin on Catholic Answers Live.
Hang on. Catholic Answers Live will return in a moment.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Go forth and preach the good news. It's not just a suggestion. If you want to take more seriously the command of Jesus to share the gospel with those around you, consider joining St. Paul Street Evangelization. It's a grassroots organization that brings the Catholic faith to the streets in a non-confrontational way. Visit our website, www.streetevangelization.com, to learn more. And don't forget to like us on Facebook. It's time to do our part.
The most original and exclusive Catholic content is on EWTN Radio.
What a great grace it is to have the opportunity to use the airwaves for the honor and glory of God, to be able to talk to the hearts of individuals and meet them where they are in their relationship with our Lord, and also to encourage them forward.
Women of Grace with Johnette Williams, tomorrow morning, 11 a.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back, Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Jimmy Akin is our guest, and a bunch of folks on the line. But you know what? I'll tell you what. You might be able to get in if you call now. If you've got a question, if you thought, nah, I won't get in now. Actually, there might. It's a possibility.
We have 18 minutes. Yeah.
Yeah. 888-318.
Well, 14 minutes.
888-318-7884. Let's go to Chad in Iowa, listening on 92.7 FM. Chad, thanks for calling. Go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
I just get one.
Well, how many do you need, Chad?
Well, I don't think you got enough time in 18 minutes.
All right. Well, let's start with one.
Okay. From the perspective
Chad, can you speak directly into your phone, please?
Is that better?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. I'm outside working. Mm-hmm. From the perspective of trying to read the Old Testament and just be, you know, I'm like, gosh, did the Jews used to think there was two gods? I mean, I guess, you know, a lot of people have no faith. They think of a wizard in the sky, but... You know, being God is so big, you know, bigger than the universe, you know, everywhere at once and every time, every place in time. I mean, we have such a small understanding, and it says that right in my New American Bible, you know, there's some revealed truths.
Yes.
You know, and I go back to the ancient writers, and I wonder, you know, of all the different ideas and arguments and... calling people heresies, you know.
Chad, no. I'm not sure what you're asking me. Could you put this in the form of a question?
Sure. You know, throughout history, everybody's had their own ideas. Mm-hmm. And I wonder, you know, maybe from different point of views, maybe in a way they're all, not all of them, but many, you know, there's different points of view that could be correct.
So the question, Church, Chad. Says, so the church?
Yeah. I mean, how is there any leeway in how you see things? I mean.
Oh, as far as church teaching goes? Like, are you allowed to be.
Yeah.
To take some things and let some other things go?
Not so simply, but I mean.
Okay.
Well, let's give that one a shot.
Let me take a stab at this, and we'll see if we need to do more. The church acknowledges that our knowledge of God is partial, that not all mysteries have been revealed to us. It also acknowledges that there is truth in every religion. That's not necessarily a lot of truth. Some religions you know, have more truth than others. Next to Christianity, Judaism has the most. But we can acknowledge that there are elements of truth in other religions. We need to use careful discernment in that process. We also can recognize that there are things we don't know as Christians. When the church has infallibly defined something, we do need to accept it as true. That doesn't mean it's the whole truth about something, but when the church infallibly defines something, well, it definitely is true. That's what infallible means, protected from being wrong. And so when we have an infallible definition, definitely we need to believe that as Catholics, because it's guaranteed to be true. And even when the church doesn't infallibly define something, we still need to give that teaching appropriate weight. And that can be that how much weight a teaching should be given depends on the level of authority the church has invested in it. It could be a very high level of authority. It could be something less than that. But that's a general sketch of the principles that I think apply in this area. We don't know everything. We do know that there are elements of truth in other religions. Sometimes you can have truths that seem to be in conflict that actually aren't, and we need to use careful discernment. But when the church infallibly teaches something, we definitely need to accept it. And even when the church does not teach infallibly, the church is still guided by the Holy Spirit, and so we need to give lesser teachings appropriate weight.
Thanks very much for the call and the question, Chad. If you'd like a book about this, you can. We'll be happy to send you Jimmy Akin's book, Teaching with Authority, which gets into pretty much every aspect of that question. I'm going to keep moving, though. I want to get as many on as I can. We'll go to Chris in Pennsylvania, listening on Holy Spirit Radio. Chris, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Oh, good evening, Jimmy. Thanks for taking my call. Jimmy, could you explain in the New Testament when Jesus said of Judas, it would have been better for that man if he had never been born? Why did Jesus say that of Judas, and what did he mean by that statement?
Well, he meant that Judas, in betraying the Son of Man, Judas was committing a very severe sin that unless he repented, he would be punished for in the afterlife, and the appropriate punishment for that would be going to hell. And it would be better to not have been born, to be stillborn, than to go to hell. So that's what Jesus meant. That doesn't tell us the ultimate fate of Judas, because Matthew says Judas repented. And whether Judas repented in the right way to be saved is something we don't know. Pope Benedict XVI said that we have to leave Judas's fate in God's hands, because we're not told flat out whether he made it or not. We're told on the one hand it would be better for him not to have been born, but we're also told he repented. And so God hasn't actually revealed to us the fate of Judas, but certainly from what Jesus said in context, Judas was committing a very grave sin in betraying him, and if he didn't repent, then he would go to hell.
And again, I'm going to leave it there. I hope that's helpful to you, Chris. I appreciate it, but I'm trying to get as many on as we can with Jimmy before we have to go today. Cheryl in St. Louis, Missouri is next, listening on 93.7 FM. Cheryl, go ahead with your question for Jimmy.
Hi. I had a question with regard to a Seventh-day Adventist that Matthew 24:20, where Jesus says, pray that your flight may not be in winter or a Sabbath. He says that's scriptural proof that Saturday Sabbath is still in effect and not Sunday. I just wondered how you would respond to that.
Well, I would respond by saying, let's look at, so this is Matthew 24 is in what's called the Olivet Discourse. It's a speech that Jesus gives on the Mount of Olives. And so I would say, let's look at the Olivet Discourse. The earliest form of it, now it's found in three different passages. In Matthew, it's chapters 24 and 25. In Mark, it's chapter 13. And in Luke, it's chapter 21. Well, if you look at the earliest version of it in Mark, Jesus has prophesied the destruction of the temple. And then the disciples come to him and say, tell us about that. And so for the rest of Mark 13, Jesus gives a speech in which he's talking about the destruction of the temple. which happened in AD 70. In Luke, you have the same thing. In Matthew, you have the same thing, but then the apostles add another question, which does deal with the end of the world. And so in Matthew's account, you have to look at which part of the Olivet Discourse we're in. The first part of Matthew's Olivet Discourse, which parallels what's in Mark 13 and Luke 21, is going to deal with the destruction of the temple. And then the parables we find in Matthew 25 are going to deal with the end of the world. So with that understanding, where, in what part does Matthew 24:20 fall? Well, it falls in the part that deals with the destruction of the temple. And Jesus says, if you look in the various synoptic gospels for this, Jesus says, you know, let those who are in Judea flee and pray that your flight is not on a Sabbath. And so in context, what that is going to mean is Jewish Christians, because he's talking to you, I mean, his followers here are Jewish Christians, pray that your flight is not going to be on the Sabbath. Well, that's because it was hard to travel on the Sabbath. People weren't working, and that would make it difficult to travel. So he's talking about what Jewish Christians were doing or would be doing in the Jewish War of the AD 60s leading up to the destruction of the temple. And we know, in fact, that the Christian community did bug out of Jerusalem, and they ended up traveling to a city named Pella, which was in the north, and they went to Pella to weather the Roman invasion. So they did have a flight, and Jesus was encouraging them to pray that it wouldn't occur on the Sabbath because it would be hard in first century Palestine to travel on the Sabbath. That doesn't tell us anything about later church history, and it doesn't tell us anything about what Gentiles need to do. In fact, St. Paul, in writing in Colossians, says, "Do not let anyone judge you in regard to a feast or a new moon or a Sabbath," those being the three kinds of liturgical days on the Jewish calendar, the annual feasts, the monthly new moons, and the weekly Sabbath. He says those were just a shadow that pointed forward to Christ, but now that the substance has come, don't let anybody judge you in terms of whether you are keeping a Sabbath or not, because Christ is the end of the law, as he says in Romans. So that's a sketch of what I would say there. Incidentally, I'm currently writing a two-part episode on Ellen G. White, the founding prophetess of Seventh-day Adventism. I'm writing that for Mysterious World. And so you might keep an eye out for that when it comes out in a few months.
Cheryl, thanks very much. I'm going to move quickly to try to get another person on at least before we have to go. I'm going to go to Lincoln, Nebraska. Granger, listening on Spirit Catholic Radio. If you want an answer, you got to be quick with this question, Granger. No? Oh, hang on, Granger. I pushed the wrong button when I needed a quick question.
Hello?
Yeah, go ahead, Granger. Ask it quickly.
Okay, you're married, it's the apocalypse, and you haven't seen your wife in years. You're not sure she's dead, but probably, and then there's only one other woman on planet Earth. Are you able to repopulate the Earth over adultery? Or, I guess, what
would that be adultery?
Say the right move?
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
Or can you at all, or what's the right move?
Okay, so in this life, we have to act based on our knowledge of situations. And in this situation, you haven't seen your wife in years. The vast majority of humans are dead because of the apocalypse. Let's say it's a nuclear war. And you know your wife is almost certainly dead. If you have moral certainty that your wife is dead, then it would be ethical to marry someone else in order to repopulate the world. If you have reason to think your wife is still alive, then the question is more complex. But if you have moral certainty your wife is dead, moral certainty is not absolute certainty, but it does mean it would be unreasonable to continue to act on the assumption my wife is still alive. And if you have moral certainty that your wife is not alive, then you would be subjectively justified in marrying someone else. Now, if your wife then shows up, you've got a more complex question, but at least you would have been acting in good faith. And even if you were wrong about your wife being dead, you would not be held accountable for that.
And in fact, the church has done a great deal of thinking about this, because this used to happen with men at sea. Women would be left not sure, but would have to act on a moral certainty. Granger, thanks. You were quick. I'm sorry I pressed the wrong button. Jimmy Akin, God bless you, and thank you for staying with us for a second hour, getting us through that.
No problem. Happy to hang out with you and everybody in the Alpha Quadrant.
And everybody in the Alpha Quadrant was probably listening. Hey, tomorrow we're going to do a show on Why Be a Woman Religious. I'm looking forward to that one. It's something I've been wanting to do for a while. And we'll have Michael Lofton on, and I don't remember the topic, but Michael's great. So see you tomorrow. God willing, right here, Catholic Answers Live.